Everything's working. Morning, Grand Officer. Morning, Grand Officer Jordan. 910 West Street. And that's all we need to know about that. Grand Officer, how old were you when you started your preaching?
Started preaching on John Henry Clay. I was 9 years old. My mother wrote my first sermon. And it was entitled, "The Lord Will Fight Your Battle." That was taken from Daniel 3, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Probably 9 years old.
9 years old. When did you know preaching was your call?
It's kind of hard to tell. When did I know that preaching was my call? I suppose 1968, is that the relationship time in New York? 1967, Eugene Lawton invited me to Newark for the Newark Lectureship. I had not preached on the National Lectureship. As a matter of fact, I was not familiar with the National Lectureship. My college of university years was at Bishop College in Dallas. I graduated Bishop College. And did my graduate work at Sam Houston State University in Huntsville, Alabama. I mean Huntsville, Texas. And so I was not familiar with the brotherhood as such. And I forgot your question. What was your question?
How did you know?
How did I know?
When did you know?
When did I know?
What was your call?
When did I know? I can't pinpoint a point in time, you know, that I knew. I believe that it was 67, is that when it was in New Jersey, because that was the first time that I was exposed to a national Church of Christ audience. I have been preaching for a long time, but my education at high school was in Bishop College, and I didn't get a chance to go to Southwestern, but I went to Bishop College. And so my exposure to preaching was from preachers like Gardner Taylor, Samuel Ray, Parson, and they will all be Baptist heritage. And so basically, I sat and listened. So I was inspired by Gardner Taylor, Ray, preacher, Senator Ray, Ray, great preacher, Caesar Clark, great preacher. So those are the guys I grew up on in terms of expostulation of the old story. And so I picked up some of their style. I never changed my doctrinal stance, because when I was 9 years old, I was traveling with John Henry Clay, and 11 years old, I was traveling with Ulysses Shields, and a few years later, I was traveling style that I took over was not necessarily a Church of Christ style. It was a Baptist style. The Baptist College was, of course, the Baptist college in the country. And so my style, when I came into the Church of Christ Brotherhood, and into the Church of Christ, I was always in the Church of Christ, but when I identified with the Church of Christ, my style had already been formulated by who I was listening to while I was in college, and it was those preachers that I mentioned. And if those of you who know anything about Black theology, I mean, you would know Gunnar Taylor Sanders, Sandra Lee Parsons, and all those things. You know those guys. Some of the best exponents those people had or had at the time. So I was exposed to those. So when I came into the Church of Christ Brotherhood, I had already formulated a style. And the style that I had formulated was not necessarily a Church of Christ style. The style that I had accumulated was basically a style that was gathered from Baptist, great Baptist preachers in their style. And these were, and I'm not talking about doctrine, I'm talking about their ability to expostulate, their ability to preach. They understood the art of preaching, how to reach people, and how to bring people forward, and that sort of thing. How to capture people, and because if you don't get them in the first 2-3 minutes, you really not gonna get them. So you have to understand those dynamics. And so I guess I would say my preaching prognostication was given me by my stay at Bishop College in Dallas, Texas.
And that explains in the younger days how you take that name, stir it all up.
So that's why I learned a lot of things. and you'll see what I'm talking about. That canal is still there, and that concrete slab that goes old past that one is still there. So we could go ahead and get educated. Now, if my grandmother knew that's the way I was, I'd get a book because she knew what those old guys was about. About lying and about whatever it is, smoking and what we weren't into drugs at the time, but she knew that whatever they were talking about, they were lying. She knew that. So she made sure that I wouldn't go to that canal, but we did anyway. So that's where I learned a lot of things. Like just listening to, you know, to those old guys.
Amen. Listen, I have two more questions, and then I'll turn it over to Dr. Penn. This one here, in terms of the church of Christ, you're talking about bishops and those preachers. Who influenced you in the ministry in terms of the church of Christ that you had shared?
John Henry Clay. Yeah, John Henry Clay was a master at preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. No one extended the invitation like John Henry Clay. Nobody could come close to that in terms of the invitation. And that's where, you know, and I together that ability to provoke people to come, you know, to come to Christ, and it worked. I baptized a lot of people, and in my gospel meetings and in my campaigns, you know, the Lord blessed me to baptize a lot of folks. Some folks I baptized even in Houston, maybe in this audience, because I held great meetings here in Houston, tent meetings in Houston, and citywide meetings in Houston. That's when Brother Edgar Scott was living there. And Paul Sutton was living during that time. And I would come in every year, and they would put up a big tent. And I would preach under the tent. And baptize right from people. So I did a lot of preaching here in Houston. And so the invitation, of course, and the ability to extend the invitation. Because to me, your sermon and your invitation was two different. Preach a message, then you've got to get the folk to accept the message. And not only get them to accept the message, but you've got to know how to encourage them to have the courage to come forward. And there are a lot of folks standing there that want to come forward and say yes to Jesus, but they're just nervous and they're crowd shy. So you have to know how to psychologically relieve them of that fear of coming down that aisle. Sometimes by themselves. So I have a methodology of going back there and getting them. When I see them coming, I go get them and walk them down the aisle. And the Lord has blessed me down through the years to develop a methodology that was designed to bring, you know, to bring people to Jesus Christ. I remember in Detroit, Michigan, Cameron Avenue. Nobody here knows anything about Cameron Avenue because it was so many years ago. But Cameron Avenue in Detroit, a Michigan, where we preached one Sunday morning. And did the first 5 minutes after death. And I guess about 27 people came forward to be baptized. And I remember Cameron Avenue because they ran out of clothes. They had never baptized that many folks at one time.
My Lord.
And so we had to hold up the baptism and safety until the sisters could go find some clothes so we could baptize those folks. But it was basically because of the invitation and trying to show people that this is the time, not tomorrow. This is the time right now. Now is the time. And I had a method by which I would help them visualize that time by is not my methodology, if you will. And I had other little techniques that was designed to encourage people to, you know, come to Christ. So the invitation was something that I worked on. I appreciate the people listening to my sermons, but then I want you to be saved. And that was a whole nother sermon altogether. It is, are y'all enjoying this?
Yeah. Amen.
I tell you, I had the experience of coming into Memphis. You would come to Memphis on the biggest tent I've ever seen in my life with the late David Shanks. And this leads me to my next question. Then you came down to a little town in Mississippi called Senatobia. They stretched the tent in the back, and you were the first preacher I ever seen really wear color. And you wore proud. And then you shocked us one night when you preached to a senior that was kind of a light green that turned off from your sweat. And when you finished, you wrapped up in a huge cake.
Yes.
And there were some people in the audience that did not like that. They thought, I live among you, so I know who you are. But this person that did you suffer as a young preacher, as it relates to politics, jealousy, and envy. I say that because when you would walk into a building, no matter where you were, it was as if all eyes were on you. Not necessarily that's what you planned, but I know with that, because you always, in my expression, acted as a woman you were to yourself. And yeah, you can come, but you can't come too close. That can create a problem. Can you talk about that for us? Oh, yes. I lived quite a bit in my early years when I came into the Church of Christ Brotherhood because of how I dress. But I came from a background and a culture in Bishop College of preachers who were dressers. They dressed to the hilt. The Church of Christ preachers didn't dress like that. They were black suit, white shirt, black tie. And I came into the brotherhood totally different. Pink suit.
Well.
The big cover. You see these preachers wearing the big covenants today. But that was not happening when I came into the Brotherhood. And because I came into the Brotherhood in that backpack, and I had a lot of problems. You probably didn't know about me, but you know, they did not see anybody quite like me. You know, gave me some problems, you know, and they tried to prove by the Bible that it was a sin to dress like I dressed. And nobody has seen the French cuffs, because I came in with French cuffs and the big, covenants. And brothers are wearing them now, but when I came in, that was taboo. I mean, you couldn't wear dresses like that in the Church of Christ. But I did. And because I did, you know, I got a lot of fun. And I even went one step further. You know, I went to the roads after I preached. And your brother could come. And we had brother who had overcoats. But I wouldn't want to step further. I had a role, and it was a fur, a white fur on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
dressed to the teeth. Dr. Washington, you used the word pioneer, and you don't use that word loosely. That is an adequate description of you and your ministry in the African American Church of Christ. Oh, what, 12 years ago, you had me to come down to Fort Lauderdale to interview you, because one thing that we have not done, so to speak, as a people of color, our history has been pretty much the oral tradition. Documentation is something that we have just begun to learn the value of. So you had me to come to Fort Lauderdale and you shared with me 2 days. And I still have those cassettes. We transcribed those interviews with you, and we are in the process of putting them in a book. But I want to say this. You told me, you said, I am the first preacher in the African American Church of Christ to be put up in a hotel when I did a gospel meeting. He said, I went to University Church in Cleveland, and when I arrived,
you want me to tell a story?
Yes, sir. You can tell it. Tell it better than me.
Yeah, that's another thing I didn't mention that. That is coming from the background I came from in terms of college, in terms of training. You know, the minister is always seen as being privileged individual. Preachers would come to the Minister's Institute in Dallas. The churches made sure that they were taken care of. And the Caesar clubs and the Parsons out of Chicago and all the great preachers of that time. They stayed in hotels. They didn't stay with anybody else. And in the 4 or 5 years that I was at Bishop's College, I mean, that's all I knew. I thought that that's where preachers lived. And that's how churches took care of that. And so when I got out on the field doing evangelistic work, he said, well, what is it? Well,
revival or a gospel meeting. That's the first time. And after that, of course, after the brethren found out that I was living in hotels, they started to rest in hotels too.
Well. Yeah, I see.
that was the first time a church Christ preacher was ever put in a hotel. Now, I fought a lot of fight because of that. Because brethren put out stories on me. If you can't get this guy, because you got to pay him $1,000, you got to fly in first class, you got to put him in a host call hotel, you got to do. And I never requested anything from anybody. Never. There was a preacher didn't want that. That will tell you that I requested a certain amount of money to come to a meeting. I have done free meetings. I have done meetings for congregations that can pay me anything. But I don't make requests. Even now, if you call me for a meeting and ask me how much I charge you, I'm never going to give you a number. I'm going to say, well, whatever you all are familiar with, and you say, hey, you know what a train is. So I'm not going to put no price on it. I never charged the church. In my life, never charged the church. But always did well. Because the church felt like they needed to do maybe more than they really should have done. But I never made a request. But that was the story that the brother put out on me. That you can't get this guy. Because if you get him, if you call him, you got to fly him in first class. You got to put him in a first class hotel. You got to pay him $1,000. You got to rent him a car. And I never requested any of that except the hotel. Now, I didn't request hotel. But all the other stuff, the brother just put that out on me. And it didn't hurt me. It hurt me. Years ago and said to me, And you know, did you ever write a letter to Dr. King? I said, I don't know. She said, well, you wrote a letter to Dr. King to encourage him in his fight for freedom. And he said, that letter is in the museum in Atlanta. I said, you gotta be kidding. She said, no, it's there. And she sent me in the information on the computer, and I went in the computer, and there was that letter. And I wrote one.
Sure.
devil. I'm speaking to that devil, and I was talking to Bill Clinton.
Because of the history that comes with Nelson Mandela. So from 910 West Street, you know, to the inauguration at the White House, speaking with Mandela, and having a letter in the rose of the Bobby the King Museum. God has brought me a long way. It hasn't been easy, but He has brought me a long way. And I'm just grateful, and I'm just humble about it. I'm not bragging about it. I'm just humble that I can come from 910 West Street with just a grandmother and a great grandmother, and those two women never went to school, but they can read and write. And every now and then they can buy me a new shirt, a new pair of jeans, or a new pair of tennis, and they would take me with them to the cotton patch, they would pick cotton. And after the cotton patch picking days were over, they would take me to the tobacco patch, and we would crop tobacco. And after that, they would take me with them to the shores. Platform where we would pull plants, and that's all they had. And
there you go.